Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
About tonight is how to be a better Bible student. Okay, now I'm not going to try to cover every single detail of every little thing that you might need to know to be a good Bible student, but I am going to hit a few high spots, because there's a couple of things we need to talk about right at the beginning to just settle some things. One is the Bible is the absolute integrity and authority of God. It is the Word of God. And because it is the Word of God, it doesn't just contain truths. See, that's what a lot of people, the way they talk about the Bible, the Bible contains truths for our lives. But what they mean is, there's some nice stuff in there that I'll grab a hold of. The rest of it, I'm going to leave. Now, the Bible is truth. Jesus said in John 17:17, sanctify them, set them aside for a holy purpose, is what sanctify means. Sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is truth. Now, is a statement of equivalence. So the word of God is truth. It is equivalent to truth. So that tells me that the Bible is not just something that God has given us to occupy our time, you know, here on the earth. Well, we ought to read our Bible. I put something on Facebook this morning as I was thinking along some of these lines, where I said that, you know, there's a whole lot of people recently went to see the movie The Interview. And they went to see the movie The Interview that was aired on Christmas Day in some theaters, certain select theaters around the country, because supposedly North Korea has tried to prevent that movie from being released. And so the thought was, if I go see this movie, I'm being a proud, patriotic American. Well, the truth of the matter is, A, we don't absolutely know for a fact that North Korea is the one that, you know, tried to stop the movie. Maybe they did. Okay, fine. Because it had some things that about Kim Jong-un, their leader, supreme leader, that was supposedly, you know, not to their liking, and so they wanted to stop it. So, okay, maybe that's the case. But all these folks came out, and actually, from what I've heard, and I haven't seen the movie, don't plan to see the movie, but from what I've heard, it is not a good movie. It's got all kinds of cussing in it. It's got all kinds of dirty jokes. It's got all kinds of off-color humor. You know, so something I wouldn't go see. I mean, just to be honest, I just wouldn't waste my time going to see this kind of movie. And I'm sure there's a whole lot of believers that went to see this movie because it's the patriotic thing to do. Well, that's all well and good, you know. But I think there's a whole lot of other things we could be doing that's patriotic, you know, that's supportive of the country without going to see an old nasty movie. But anyway, point is, I saw that and then I went on to see a posting that ISIS had started killing Christians if they even read their Bible. You know, if they saw them, heard word that they were reading their Bible, they were going to kill them, behead them. And so I thought, well, if that's the case, then in order to kind of be a patriotic Christian, then what we ought to do is read our Bible, just to spite them, you know? And I got to thinking about that, and I thought, yeah, you know, that's the truth. We ought to just read our Bible. And then I got to thinking, well, you know, the cool thing about reading your Bible is, not only is it going to make ISIS upset, which I'm all for, but at the same time, it's going to bless you. Matter of fact, we know that specifically the book of Revelation says that you are blessed if you read it. So if you ever want to get blessed, just read the book of Revelation. Now, I know a lot of people say, well, Dr. Bill, I'm not going to read the book of Revelation. It's got all this negative stuff in it that I'm going to get it all scared and upset. Well, why? We win. You know, it's like the old thing about read the back of the book, we win. Well, yeah, that's the back of the book, we win. Okay, so you don't have to get all bent out of shape and upset about the book of Revelation. Matter of fact, there's a lot of good stuff in there. But the point is, the Bible is the integrity, the authority of the Word of God. All right? Now, saying that, let's look at a couple of things. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. And by the way, just so you'll know, I have my official edition of the Kenneth Hagin Rhema Study Bible that I'm using. I don't even have my computer tonight. That's got to be a first, for at least in a long time, okay? So I'm going old school tonight. Praise the Lord. All right, so 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now that tells me you could wrongly divide the word of truth. He wouldn't tell you to rightly divide it if it was impossible to divide it incorrectly, okay? So we're to rightly divide the word of truth. But here's what I want you to see. This word, verse 15, study, to show thyself approved. Now, it's interesting. When I read that back in high school, when I'd go to study hall at high school, I'd read my Bible instead of my textbooks. And perhaps my grades would have improved a little had I read some of those textbooks. But, praise the Lord, I was turned on to the Word of God and excited about the things of God, and that's what I did, is I read my Bible. Well, I would read this scripture and say, study to show thyself approved, and say, see there, I need to study more. And I took it to mean study the Word, study. Well, this word, this is where I want to get into something about biblical interpretation. It's one thing to read something, for instance, here from the King James, where it says, study to show thyself approved, and say, I need to study. That's fine. And that's true. It's just not what the Scripture says. And you go, what? Well, hold on. The word study here is the Greek word spoudazo. Boy, don't you love that word. That's a great one there, spoudazo. It sounds like something you do after you taste something funny, you know? Spoudazo. It means to use speed. That is, to make an effort, to be prompt and to be earnest. Well, okay, let's take that definition and plug it into this verse. It says, make an effort to show thyself approved unto God. Now that, in other words, is not saying study the Word of God directly. You see what I'm saying? It's saying do, make an effort, be prompt to be approved unto God. Now that doesn't mean we don't study. You see what I'm saying? It's just that if you quote the Scripture and say, see, I'm supposed to study to show myself approved, yes, I'll agree with you, but not by strict biblical interpretation from this Scripture. There's plenty of other scriptures that says read the Word of God. There are plenty of other scriptures that say study the Word of God. There are scriptures that say meditate on the Word of God. I'm not taking anything away from all of that. But in this particular scripture, specifically, we're not told to study. We're told to be prompt and to make an effort to show yourself approved unto God. Now, to be prompt and make an effort to show yourself approved unto God, what do? You study the Word of God. Yes. Okay, you see what I'm saying? But the point is, if I get hung up on this definition of study, meaning that I am to study the Word of God, and then many years later, after I've quoted that and spoken that and enthusiastically told people that's what it means, and then somebody tells me, well, actually, you know, that doesn't mean the word study, like to study the Bible. It just means to make an effort. Well, I could get all bent out of shape about that. And I could say, now hold on here. You're wrongly dividing the word of truth. Well, no. Now hold on. The way to know what the Scripture is actually talking about is to look at the original meaning of the words. Now we can do that. You know, I'm not a Greek scholar in the sense that I can read and write Greek. I'm not a Hebrew scholar in the sense that I can read and write Hebrew. But I can be scholarly in my approach to Hebrew and Greek by studying reference materials that teach me about Hebrew and Greek words that give me the exact definition. Now, this specific definition came in Strong's Concordance. It told me that this is the Greek word spoudazo. I didn't know that before I read it. It told me that it is to use speed, that is to make an effort to be prompt or earnest. Gave me the definition. And once I saw that, I could incorporate that understanding into that scripture. So you see how that works? Studying is a good thing. Don't get me wrong. But studying will show you that certain scriptures that have been taken to mean one thing may not mean that thing. And I've heard people say this my whole Christian life. And I've had people just stand me down, want to argue with me, telling me that the Bible is full of contradictions. And I always say, show me one. And they laugh. Because they say, oh, Dr. Bill, I can show you thousands. Really? Show me one. You still haven't shown me the first one yet. Well, and they get sputtering because they realize they can't think of one. Well, I know there is one. And so I'll go find out. I told this one guy who was absolutely determined. He said, I can get one for you. I said, okay, fine. You go. And I said, here's the rules. Before we got to establish some rules. The rules are, check what the Word of God says, study it from the original languages, and compare it in multiple translations and multiple study guides before you come back and tell me you found a contradiction. All right, fine, not a problem. Never did hear from that guy. Never saw him again. Well, why you reckon that is? Because he was determined. He absolutely knew it was full of contradictions. Thing is, it's not full of contradictions if you understand it, if you understand the context, and you find out that the Bible always answers itself. It always explains itself. Now, let's look at, I can see I'm going a little different direction than I thought I was going to go, but that's okay. Yeah, I'm like, I've been around pastor long enough to know if the Lord leads you off in a different direction, just go with it. You got to leave your notes, leave them. They're still good notes. They'll be there next time. Well, let's look at John chapter 10. And this is a very, very familiar scripture. Verse 10, the thief, this is good King James. You got to love the King James here. The thief cometh not but for two. Well, that's King James if I ever heard it. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. Well, let's kind of make that a little more modern English. The devil is the thief, and he only comes to do these three things. That's the only reason he shows up. Now, this cometh not but for to, that's what that means. All right? He only comes for these three reasons. What are the three reasons? To kill, to steal, and to destroy. Now, you've heard pastors say this, and I think it's a great thing to do. I encourage people to do this myself. Take a piece of paper, write down everything on one column, and at the top of the column put the devil. On the other column put God. Then start listing out all the things that you may have attributed to God, but it kills, it steals, or it destroys. Does sickness and disease kill, steal, and destroy? Absolutely. Well, we got to put that into the devil column. Yeah, but I want to put it in the God column because my church always taught that God was the one making us sick to teach us something. Hold on now. See, we got to go back to what we agreed earlier. We got to study it out. We got to apply what we're applying here. So we're going to take our two columns. We're going to write down, well, it's sickness and it's killing and stealing and destroying, and that's the devil. Well, it's healing. Well, that's a good thing. That's not sickness. That's not killing. That's not stealing. That's not destroying. It's a good thing. We'll put that under God's column. And sure enough, if you'll do that diligently, you'll get a list of everything in your life that's of the devil and everything in your life that's of God. And you'll be very surprised at how much wiser you will be in your approach to life. And how much you will be a better Bible scholar. Because if you quit attributing to God the things that are of the devil, things start getting clearer. Now, let's keep reading here. It says, the thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, destroy. Then Jesus said, I am come for a reason, right? I am come that they might have life. That's the Zoe life of God. That's the Greek word Zoe. The Zoe life of God, and that they might have it, that's the life, more abundantly. So Jesus came to give us life, and he came to give us that life in an abundant fashion. All right? The Zoe life of God is the life. It's going to sound squirrely, but hang in there. There's a whole lot of people hear this and go, oh my, he's getting deep now. Hold on. What I'm about to say is the Zoe life of God is the life force that keeps this universe from dying. Now, it's not the force Don't get weird on me. See, you people hear you say that and they go, oh, yes, yes, I understand exactly. No, you don't. No, the Zoe life of God is God's life. God's life. The life of God that he uses to, in effect, animate. You remember when he created Adam initially? He created him out of the dust of the earth. It'd be like making a, for lack of better, a mud guy. You know what I'm saying? In other words, he shaped him kind of like clay. Shaped him and made him look just like himself. Now, again, that's what the Hebrew says. He said, let us, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the Trinity, let us make man in our image. Now, have you ever thought about that? That's actually kind of cool to think about. We are a spirit, we have a soul, we live in a body. God has mind, will, and emotions. He is a spirit. The Bible says he's a spirit. And Jesus is his physical body. Just say it. Okay? Just kind of meditate on that one. Anyway, so God creates this mud guy, and he looks like God. Matter of fact, looks like a mirror image. But he's dead. There's no life in him. And it says God breathed into him the breath of life. Life. The breath of life. Well, the word breath is the Hebrew word roush. I like to say it that way because that's literally where that sound of that word came from. Roush. In other words, like breath, like air blowing. It literally means not just breath, it also means spirit. God took of his own spirit life and breathed into this mud guy life, and he became a living soul, the scripture says. At that point, he was no longer just an inanimate object of mud or clay or dirt. He became a living soul. That means he was alive. That means he had mind, will, and emotions. Matter of fact, we found out that Adam was a pretty sharp guy before the fall because he literally named all the animals and he didn't consult any books to do it. There weren't any. He named them what he named them, and the Word of God says whatever he called them is what we still call them. Now, whatever language he was using, I don't know. You know, it probably wasn't English, but you understand what I'm saying. He spoke, he named, he recalled, and he retained that information. So he's a pretty sharp guy. But he wasn't so sharp when it came to spiritual things, unfortunately, because when the devil came in, God had already told him, you have absolute dominion, you have power, you have authority, you can cast the devil out, you know, in so many words. And so the devil comes, deceives Eve, but Adam, it says, was not deceived, being in the transgression. He saw what was going on, and for whatever reason, he didn't throw the devil out of the garden. Wish he had, but he didn't. So, point being, he was a sharp guy mentally, but he wasn't necessarily so sharp spiritually, unfortunately. And, of course, everything happened that happened. We're not going to go into all of that. That would take us days and days and days. But the point is, this life force that God breathed into Adam also became a life force that created everything, caused everything to be made alive. So, Jesus came to give us life, and that more abundantly. I love the fact that he came to give us life, which is good. Matter of fact, if you think about it, if he came to give us life, that means he came to give us healing. Because healing is an application of the life of God. Amen. He came to give us all kinds of good things, but he came to do it in abundance. That's just the way God is. He's always dealing with abundance. He never just meets you halfway. He never just meets you, you know, like I'm gonna just meet your need. He always goes above and beyond. And I just like that about God. And so that's what Jesus says here. He says, I'm come to give you life and that more abundantly. The devil has come to give you sickness, disease, killing, stealing, destroying. Well, that ought to tell you something about the devil. And it ought to tell you something about God. Now, I say all that to say this. If you have that basic understanding that the devil is bad and God is good, I'm just simplifying it, just making it as simple as I can here. then when you read something in the Bible, you've got to reconcile it with that essential truth. Amen. God's good, devil's bad. I heard a song a long time ago. I think it may have been Randy Stonehill. I don't remember. But he in his verse, he said, God is good and the devil is bad. And I'm like, boy, that's a heavy revy. But then I got thinking about it. I thought, you know, that really is a heavy revy. Because a whole lot of Christians don't have that heavy revy. They still think God's bad, the devil's good. I tell you what, I know that sounds crazy to our ears. You know, word of faith turned on tongue-talking, you know, faith people. But when I grew up in the Southern Baptist Church, we had a real good understanding that that healing stuff was the devil. And, you know, and people getting healed. And we were like, oh, now I wouldn't mess with that. That's of the devil. And God got credit for people dying. God got credit for babies dying. People dying early. And he's God. Everybody was like, yes, he had a greater purpose. We don't understand it. Well, maybe you're just plain wrong. You know, hate to throw water all over your theory, but it's the truth. Dry air is working on my throat. Okay, let's keep that in mind. But let's go over to James chapter 1. Yeah, I still hadn't got to my first scripture yet. Well, I got my first one, but I didn't get my second one. That's okay. James chapter 1. And James here has a lot to say. I'm not gonna hit every spot in here, but let's look at a few high spots. Verse 5 says, if any of you lack wisdom, well, let me say this. If you're studying the Word of God, first thing you need to do is pray for wisdom. Amen. Because there's a whole lot of people out there teaching stuff that's not wise. Okay? If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. Now, here's what happens when you ask of God. He gives to all men liberally. Now, there's that abundance again. Amen? He gives to all men liberally. He upbraids not. Now, the word upbraid in the King James just simply means to find fault. Now, see, God, if he wanted to, he could find a lot of fault in our theology. But he just doesn't do that. He doesn't bother. No, he gives us the wisdom. Let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. It shall be given to him. I missed that part. He does not find fault, but it shall be given to him. Let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven by the wind and tossed. Let that not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Now, there you go. If you're double-minded, you know, well, now God could be causing this, or it could be the devil, or see, you're double-minded. You got to find out what's the truth and stick with that. Stay with the truth of the Word of God. Let the brother of low esteem rejoice in that he is exalted, and the rich that he is made low, because the flower of the grass passes away. Now let's go over to verse 13. Let no man say when he is tempted. Now the word tempted here means tempted, tested, or tried. Tempted, tested, or tried. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. Now how many of you have heard, and you don't have to raise your hand, have heard people say, I'm being tempted, tested, and tried of God? Well, bless your darling heart. The Bible says don't say that. Don't say that. Well, what does that say about the truth of that? It can't be true because God said don't say it. Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. Does God ever tempt someone to sin? Ever? Has there been one recorded case? No. Okay. Keep that in mind. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Now, again, that's King James, but let's put it in good old regular English. Don't make a mistake, my beloved brethren. So we got a lot of beloved brethren out there that are making mistakes based on what we're reading right here. Because they're blaming God for their problem, their test, their trial. There are people blaming God for their sin. You've heard Pastor tell the story about the people that say, God made that person a prostitute in order for him to teach them some greater thing. Well, if he's put them in sin directly against the word of God, if God did that, this scripture is rendered null and void. And let me tell you something about scripture. It never is rendered null and void. When every man is tempted, he's drawn away of his own lust and he's enticed. And when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. Do not make a mistake, my beloved brethren. Verse 17. That's where we're trying to get. Every good gift. Okay, hold on. Is it a good gift to be healed? Yes. Is it a good gift to receive financial blessing? Yes. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. Is that God or the devil? It's God. God is the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. So let's, again, put that in good old regular English. God is not wishy-washy. I had that revelation many years ago. It was a great and formidable revelation that God is not wishy-washy. Okay. Because that's what this scripture means. There's no variableness. He's not wavering. Remember the unstable man, the double-minded man. He's wavering. God's not that way. He's always stable. He's always solid. Right? So if God's that way, then let's keep reading and see what it has to say about it. There's no variableness. There's neither shadow of turning. Of his own will begat he us with the what? Word of truth. We already found out from John 17:17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. The word is truth. The word of truth is the word of truth, right? It's the word of God. That we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, for the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted or implanted word. Receiving the word is a seed that gets planted in your heart. The engrafted word, which is able to save your souls, and that is the word soul, psuche, which is the mind, the will, and the emotions. Your pneuma, your spirit man, is saved when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord. But your soul, your mind, your will, and emotions have to be renewed to the Word of God. Now, all of that being said, let's look at a scripture. Let's go over to Job chapter 1. And actually, I have it here in my notes, so I'm just going to read it here. No, I started to, but let's go to Job. Book of Job. I heard somebody say many years ago, the book of Job. I always wonder if that's where you go to find one. A job. Oh, that's bad. All right. You know, the Word of God does promise that if you need a job, you can get one. And you say, well, where's that at? You know, the one problem about using my official Rhema Study Bible is that it is not well worn. I use it as a reference Bible instead of a regular Bible like my computer Bible. And so I'm having a hard time locating. Let me do this. I'll show you a trick. Take your Bible and you flip it to the middle. That is Psalms and Proverbs. It works every time if you do that. And then from there, you can usually find what you're looking for. There's Job. I knew he was in there. All right, Job. But the thing is, and I was making a little side point there, so I'll keep doing that while I find my verse I'm looking for. Good old Philippians 4:19. For my God shall supply all your need according to riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We're very familiar with that scripture. Not a lot of Christians, because they haven't studied, know that the word need there means employment. So my God shall supply your employment according to his riches and glory. Now, it doesn't just mean employment. It does also mean needs, like we think of needs. But I just think it's interesting that one of the first meanings is employment. So if you ever run across somebody saying, I need a job, well, go to that scripture, stand on it, and believe to receive employment because it's right there. Praise the Lord. All right. Job 1. Now, Job, the reason I go to Job is a good example of a book that has been thoroughly misunderstood. Completely and totally misunderstood on almost every level. Okay? Yet it is the oldest book of the Bible. If it were, I wouldn't have had a problem finding it if it were listed in chronological order because it'd be the very first one. It's the oldest book. And it's the oldest book, and it's also an interesting book because it is a book about a man who had a personal covenant with God before Abraham had his covenant with God. Before any of the other people that we have listed in the Bible had a covenant with God, Job had a covenant. Specifically, he individually had a covenant with God. A lot of people don't think about that. But again, if you'll understand that, a lot of what he says here will make a whole lot more sense. Now, Job's biggest problem was that he did move by fear concerning his children. Now, we can find that out if we go to Job chapter 6. We'll find out that Job makes the statement, Lord, teach me wherein I have erred, and I will hold my tongue. I will quit talking because apparently I'm saying something that's not right. Okay? And I need you to instruct me and tell me where I've missed it. And we end up finding out that where he missed it was concerning his children. He just made the assumption that they were all in sin, and he was constantly making sacrifice for them over and over and over. Well, I'll tell you, it's like praying over and over and over. Then that means the first, second, and third time you weren't in faith. All right? And so all those sacrifices he was making really were in unbelief. And so that's where he got off. And when he got off, let's look at verse 5. Back up to verse 4. Chapter 1, verse 4. And his sons went and feasted in their houses every one their day and sent and called for the three sisters to eat and drink with them. In other words, they were partying. And it was so, when the days of their feastings were gone about, Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, he's about to say something. What'd he say? It may be, he doesn't know for a fact, but it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. Well, right there is his problem. We found it. Now, Job didn't know that. That's why in chapter 6 he asked the Lord to reveal to him, what have I said that I shouldn't have said? Where have I made a mistake? Wherein have I erred? But here's where he erred. Verse 6, and there was a day. Now, the scene changes here, but it's because of what was just said. The scene changes because there was a day when the sons of God, now this sons of God is talking about spiritual beings. It is a broader term than the Son of God, specifically Jesus, all right? So spiritual beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. So we know he's not talking about sons of God like they're all good guys, because the devil was there too. And the Lord said unto Satan, hey, why are you here? Right? King James says, whence comest thou? Same thing. Then Satan answered the Lord and said, well, I've come from going to and fro about the earth and walking up and down on it. In other words, I've been getting into everybody's business. And the Lord said unto Satan, well, hey, have you considered my servant Job? In other words, a lot of people read this and say, see, God was dangling Job out there in front of the devil and hoping he would grab him and do some terrible stuff to him. That's what it was all about. No. The devil said he was going around the earth, obviously looking into the lives of people. And so God says, well, tell you what, have you considered my servant Job? Why? He goes on to say, there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man. Wouldn't you like God to say that about you? A perfect and upright man, one that fears God, in other words, fears me, and eschews or refuses evil. And Satan answered the Lord and said, well, does Job fear God for nothing? Getting uppity. Hast thou not made a hedge about him? In other words, I looked for this guy, and I found out there is a spiritual force field around this guy. I can't get to him. I can't hurt him. I can't destroy him. Last time Satan looked at Job, he had a force field. Now, I know that sounds real science fiction-y, but that's really what he's talking about here. A hedge, a spiritual, supernatural field around Job that he couldn't get through. And he was a bit ticked off about it, because the devil wanted to get in there and mess him up. But instead, God had this protective shield around him. Why? Because he was in faith and he was a man of God. But what did we just read? He let down that hedge. He let down that faith. So he says, he has this hedge about him, this force field, about his house, his whole house, and about all that he has on every side. In other words, every single thing he owns is covered by this force field. Thou hast blessed the work of his hands. God, this isn't fair. You got him protected, and now you bless it, everything that he touches. Sounds about right. And his substance is increased in the land. That means he has abundance. But God, this is Satan talking, but put forth your hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. Basically, what Satan's saying is, I can't do it because of this force field. But you do it, and you just watch. He'll curse you. So what does God say? The Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Now see, a lot of people read this. This is where people aren't good Bible students. They read this and say, see, God took down the force field. He took down the hedge. He said, have at him, Satan. That's what he did. No. He made a statement. Look, behold, all that he has is in thy power. Why? Because he got out of faith. Satan was too stupid to understand that the hedge was already down. Last time he checked, it was up, but it's down now. And he just hadn't checked. So the Lord says, well, look, all he has is in your power. Only upon himself put forth not thine hand. Why? Because God wanted him to do all these terrible things but wanted to protect Job's life? No, because Job never got in fear and unbelief over his own life. He got in fear and unbelief over the lives of his sons and his daughters, his family, his stuff. But his personal life, he never wavered. So God said, you can't touch his life, but all the other stuff, there's no force field anymore. Okay, there was, so Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. He's going to check this out. He's going to make sure, is that force field really down? And there was a day when the sons and daughters were eating and drinking in their eldest brother's house. There came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing, the asses feeding beside them. The Sabaeans fell upon them, and all this terrible stuff happened. Okay? All this stuff was going on. And Job is seeing all the terrible things that have happened. They were all dead. Verse 19. Verse 20. Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshipped and said. Notice what he said. Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, how many people have you heard read this, particularly at funerals, and say, the Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Meaning, God is the one killing this person. God is the one stealing all this stuff. God is the one causing all this trouble. Is that what Job really said? Now, here's the thing. I was talking to Ben about this. Now, Ben and I, we were talking this afternoon about this very scripture. And Ben's been raised in the Word of God from day one. He knows what he knows about the Word. And so I made the statement, yeah, there's a lot of people saying, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And it's accurate that Job said that, but that's the fact that it's accurately in there that Job said that doesn't mean that it's true. My point was going to be, because I was going to bring this up in our teaching tonight, my point was going to be the Bible could report something is true and not agree with it. Job could say, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, and that not be the truth, but Job did say it. See what I'm saying? That was my point. And then here Ben comes along and says, well, depends on how you look at it. The Lord does take away sickness. He does take away disease. He does take away poverty. And He gives blessing. You know, the Lord does give and take away. It just depends on what you're talking about. So it led me to a deeper study. Remember, we're talking about study to show yourself approved. We're talking about being a good Bible student. So I read the next verse. Lo and behold, in all this Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. That tells me something. Job didn't blame God. See, most people stop there at verse 21. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, woe is me, Lord. See, Job was, he was grieving. His sons had died. His daughters had died. All his stuff was gone. It was a bad day. The man was having a bad day. But at no point did he curse God. That's what the devil wanted him to do. That was his specific goal, was to get him to curse God. Did he curse God? No. At no point did he sin or charge God foolishly. So when he said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, he must have not meant the Lord kills and steals and destroys. Because we know from the scripture that we read over in John chapter 10 that it's the devil that comes to kill, steal, and destroy. So who killed his kids? The devil. Who stole his stuff? The devil. Job said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. That's all we know. We don't know what he's saying about what was taken away. We don't know that he was saying that God took it away. Because the very next verse, matter of fact, let's read it out of a couple of references, translations. The Message Bible says, verse 21, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I will return to the womb of the earth. God gives, God takes. That's all he's saying is God gives, God takes. He didn't say what. But he did say, God's name be forever blessed. Not once through all this did Job sin. Not once did he blame God. Well, isn't that news to Baptists? I say that because I was raised Baptist, all right? I don't have any particular thing against Baptist other than I was one, okay? But that was the way we always heard it. God's the one did all this. But nowhere in this book of Job does it say God did any of this. Matter of fact, we will find out later that he didn't do it. And that later on when Job repented and he prayed for his friends, in other words, he got back into faith, God gave him double and triple everything he had. So God gave in that case. Well, let's keep reading. Amplified says, and Job said, naked or without possessions came I into this world from my mother's womb, and naked and without possessions shall I depart. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed, praised, and magnified in worship be the name of the Lord. In all this Job sinned not nor charged God foolishly. The Darby version. Naked, without possessions, came I into the world from mother's womb, and naked, without possessions, shall I depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed, praised, and magnified in worship be the name of the Lord. In all this Job sinned, nor charged God foolishly. So there's something at work here we're missing. If he's saying, I didn't blame God for this, which is what he's basically saying. Even that one translation even specifically said, he didn't blame God. So you can't say he blamed God by saying God takes it away. And then the very next verse say he didn't blame God. That would be a contradiction, but I don't think it's a contradiction because I think Ben's 100% right. God does give, he does take away. He gives blessing, he gives life, he gives health, but he does take away sickness, he takes away disease, he takes away negative things. Absolutely, I agree with that. And Job's statement that God does give and God does take away is absolutely true. But he didn't blame God. And if the point that people are trying to say is that he blamed God, they're wrong because the Bible specifically says he didn't blame him. So again, you've got to read with wisdom and with a prior knowledge of everything the Bible teaches. Otherwise, you'll start getting confused. It's easy to fall into that thing of, well, yeah, but you know, if God hadn't pointed out that that hedge was down, all God did was say, look, it's down. He didn't take it down. He didn't cause it to be taken down. He didn't create the situation for it to be taken down. Job did. It was entirely Job's fault and responsibility. It was not God's. And God didn't tempt him. God didn't try him. But the devil certainly came in and caused problems. And that's exactly the lesson that people need to learn today. Not looking for how God did it, but the fact that Satan uses opportunity when you get out of faith. Which ought to tell some of these folks that are, you know, oh, you know, throwing the flowers, and no, we're all just under grace. We don't have to do anything. We have to stay in faith. We can do whatever we want. Not if you want to stay protected. You've got to stay in faith. All right, let's look at another scripture over at Luke 18. This is the scripture concerning the unjust judge. There's a lot of people take this and just get all squirrely over it. But Luke 18:1 says, Jesus said, he spake a parable unto them to the end that they ought always to pray and not to faint. Now that's telling me that his point was we ought always to pray and not faint. Am I off base there? That's what it says. Verse 2, saying, there was in a city a judge who feared not God and regarded not man. Now let me ask you something about the judge. Based on this, was he a good guy? No. Why? Because he did neither. Let me back up. Oh, I was looking at the wrong scripture. Sorry. I'm looking at the one I'm going to talk about after this. He feared not God. Fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, right? Scripture says that. And he regarded not man. So he wasn't a good guy. There was a widow in that city. She came oft unto him, King James again, she came a lot unto him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regardeth man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest she wear me out by her continual coming. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge saith. Now, this judge, what did Jesus say about him? He was unrighteous. He did not fear God, so he had no wisdom. He didn't take any men's standing into account. He was unrighteous. You know what I've heard said about the unjust judge? I've heard people say the unjust judge is God. What? What? They're saying that what Jesus is saying is God's unjust, I assume. And you just got to keep berating him and praying at him. And eventually, he'll just say, oh man, you keep bugging me. I'm just going to give it to you because you just keep bugging me. And they say that's God. Now, if you just think a minute, he's unrighteous. He doesn't fear God. He must not be God. Okay? So who would that be? Who's that sound more like? Sounds more like the devil. He doesn't fear God. He doesn't respect God. He doesn't account for anything about men. He's unjust. Sounds like the devil. Well, let's think about that a minute. Who's holding out and keeping blessing from coming? I'd say that'd be the devil and his crowd. Right? So who do we need to be persistent about? The devil, because we pray and we stand in faith on the word of God against the wiles of the devil. And that's what he's talking about. He said so. He's not talking about God being unjust. And yet people have thought that's what he was saying. Now let's cover one more. I think there's only one more. Yes, there's only one more. And it's the one I was trying to read a while ago and I got all sidetracked on. John chapter 9, the disciples are out, they're listening to Jesus teach, and they pass by this guy. As he passed by, he saw a man blind from his birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, which means teacher, they've been listening to him teach, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he should be born blind? Now, what does that tell us about what they were saying? There apparently was a doctrine that the scribes and Pharisees must have taught them as they were coming up as good Jewish boys, that somebody is born blind if they sinned. Now, first of all, that doesn't make a lot of sense, because how could they have sinned before they were born if they were born blind? How does that work? So apparently, obviously that's wrong. Okay, yeah, spooky, weird stuff. But, okay, maybe it was his parents. His parents sinned, that's why he was born blind. So this is obviously a doctrine that they have. Now, what they're wanting to know is Jesus, do you agree with that doctrine? Really, when you get right down to it. Jesus answered, neither did this man sin. Well, now, hold on. Is it possible this man was born without sin, never sinned in his whole life? No, because only Jesus was born without sin and never sinned in his whole life, right? So obviously he committed sin, but what Jesus is saying, again, we got to understand what we're talking about. Jesus is answering the question. It was not because of this man's sin that he was born blind, is what he's saying. That's what he's answering. He said, neither did this man sin, nor his parents. In other words, it wasn't his sin, and it wasn't his parents' sin. But, notice there's a colon there. But, that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Oh, well, that's why he was born blind, because God knew Jesus was going to heal him. That's why. Well, now, no, because if that's true, then God does kill, steal, and destroy. If that's true, then everything we've studied and read prior to this must be wrong. So that we're missing something here. So this gets back to us being a good Bible student. Here's what we need to understand about Greek. There's no colons. There's no periods. There's no capital letters. It's one big, long, run-on sentence. Amen. I mean, really, that's really what it boils down to. If you read Greek, you don't see a capital letter, so you don't see a capital G God. You don't see a period, like I'm finished with this statement. You have to read the sentence and make sense of it based on the words in the sentence without the punctuation. Now, obviously, that can lead to some problems. So let's read it without punctuation. Disciples ask him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he should be born blind? Jesus answered, neither did this man sin nor his parents. In other words, it wasn't the sin that caused the blindness. But that the works of God should be made manifest in him, we must do the works of him that sent me. Well, now, wait a minute. Let's back up. It wasn't the man's sin or his parents' sin that caused to be born blind. Stop. But that the works of God should be made manifest in him, we must work the works of him that sent me. While it's day, the night cometh when no man can work, but I am in the world and the light of the world. In other words, let's heal him. That makes perfect sense. It wasn't that he was made sick for God to be able to heal him. What Jesus is saying, boys, this is the dumbest doctrine I've ever heard. It wasn't the guy's sin, it wasn't the parent's sin, but I tell you what we're going to do. Long as we're here, let's heal this guy for the glory of God. Amen? Am I completely misreading this? No. So, if we did not understand that there's no punctuation, we could misunderstand this. But by understanding there's no punctuation, there's no capital letters, etc., etc., once we understand context, once we understand Scripture and how it's all put together, once we understand that God specifically told us that Satan's the one that comes to kill, steal, and destroy, that Jesus has come to give life to that more abundantly, that is the great dividing line, battle line between God and the devil. That if we understand that, we can understand a whole lot more. So if God made this man sick for his greater glory, something's wrong with our theology. So that means we have to stop, step back, and say, okay, Let's read this, understanding there's no punctuation, and see if it makes sense. And when we did, it made sense. So there was no contradiction. And that's how it works. And that's how we can be better Bible students, is to simply understand that this word has been given to us as an instruction book. But it's an instruction book that there's certain things about it we have to understand. You know, there's certain things about computers that I have to understand to work on computers. Computers, this will be a great revelation to you. Computers are not random. In the sense that they are designed to understand that a zero is a zero and a one is a one, and they never get them confused. And all that code that runs through them, what that computer spits out is no better or worse than the program that was written. The computer is not out to get you. The computer doesn't have it in for you. I've heard this said. I've heard people say, that computer's out to get me. No, the computer could care less. It does not even have the ability to care. It doesn't have the ability to be ornery. You may feel like it is, but it's not. It's just a hunk of machinery. And it operates according to certain rules and principles. And amazingly enough, our lives operate according to certain rules and principles. And they always work. And even when we don't like that rule or principle, it still works. Words still are important. What we say out of our mouth still determines the cycle of natural events in our life. And you may say, I don't like that, Dr. Bill. Don't care. That's the system. It's the way it works. It's the ones and zeros. It's the way it is. So we have to get a hold of our tongue. We have to say what the Word of God has to say. We have to guard against things that are negative, hearing it or coming out of our mouth. I was talking to Belinda over Christmas about something. I forget what it was now. I can't even remember the situation. But I started to say something, and my little confession beeper went off, don't say that. Well, it meant that I didn't say anything. She was asking me a question. I went, and I didn't say anything. And she's like, what's the problem? And I said, I'm looking for a better word than the word I was going to use because what I was going to say was going to be negative. She said, oh, okay, I understand that. Because I just watch what I say. And a lot of people, Dr. Bill, you don't have to do that. No, I don't have to, but if I'm going to live a long life on the earth, I'd better. You know? I mean, I'm 59 years old now. Praise the Lord. I had somebody tell me when I was a teenager. They said, yeah, heavy as you are and this, that, and the other, and your father and mother's conditions and this, that, and the other, you'll never live past 42. And you know, that got in my heart, and I thought about that. And I'm talking 16, 17-year-old kid. I'll never live past 42. Do you know, Elvis believed he'd never live past 42. He confessed he'd never live past 42, and he did. He died at 42. So fortunately, I found out enough about the Word of God to find out, no, I'm going to live long on the earth. Hallelujah. You know, next November 30th, I'll turn 60. So I will officially, finally be middle-aged. Hallelujah. It occurred to me, I thought, 60 years old, I'll be middle-aged. What do you know? So, I mean, everything up to now has been, I'm a young whippersnapper, you know. So, but yeah, it's just all how you look at it. So I got thinking about that today. I thought, well, praise the Lord, 59, that's well past 42. I'm done with that one. I'm done with that thought. Not that I ever dwelt on it very long, but it did at the time. It stuck with my mind. I thought, yeah, you know. Because I mean, Belinda and I were talking today about several people who passed away prematurely. They died young. From our perspective, you know. Now, this one individual we were talking about was like 62. Well, that's nothing. 62, my goodness. So don't set yourself up for sickness and disease. Don't set yourself up for failure. Don't set yourself up for poverty and lack. Confess the Word of God. We've heard it, we know it, but we got to do it. Praise the Lord. And that's a whole nother topic, but it's just been on my heart, so I had to throw it out there. Praise the Lord. So, get anything out of this? Hallelujah. I enjoyed being Ben talking about these things. I like that he brought up something. And I went, yeah, that's right. Praise the Lord. That's a good thing. See, that's that old Baptist nature. You got to dig it out. You know, I like what Norval Hayes said one time. He said he'd get down on the floor and he'd beat the floor. Lord, deliver me of my First Baptist mind. Lord, deliver me of my First Baptist mind. And when I heard him say that, I started laughing because I thought, you know, he's absolutely right. I got to be delivered of all that mess I heard my whole life up to a certain age. And then I received the left foot of fellowship from among the Baptists, as Brother Hagin said, and the rest is history, but praise the Lord.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.